Back to Work in Malta, the second Giant Showcase. This one is with Toby Young, who will talk us through the GN3 Plus service catalogue. So the floor is yours, Toby.
Okay, thanks very much, Jim. Thank you, everybody, for attending. It's a small but select group, and it's getting larger by the second, I notice. I think last week we managed to get 25 attendees. We're currently heading rapidly in that direction, so that's good news. In the next 15 minutes, what I want to do is just to run through a little bit of a presentation which I'll be giving to the EC Year 4 reviewers on what product management has done for the GN3 service. And then the second half of the presentation, I'll take a look at the GN3 service set, see how it's migrated forward into GN3 Plus, and just look at the finally end up with a presentation of the portfolio of the GN3 Plus service catalogue as it stands today, and hopefully give you a snapshot of what the service catalogue should look like when we exit GN3 Plus in a year and a half's time. So with no further ado, let's just crack on into that and press on. I'm happy to take questions sort of during the session, as it says in the window, or say afterwards. Will be probably about 10 minutes or so to ask any questions you might have. What I want to cover off is what we've been doing in product management. Product management is made up of myself, Domenico, who works with me on product management activity, and it's a matrix management activity, so all of the task leaders and activity leaders within the Jump project have some dotted line interaction with my function. So we'll be just covering off what we've been doing in product management, and then, as I say, we'll take a look at the service catalogue itself. Essentially, the key things in product management, we've been looking at defining a process last year for managing products and services within Giant. We trained up 25 or so, might have been 30 activity and task leaders by the time we'd finished our training activities last year. And we built a product lifecycle management portal, which you'll see the URL for in the bottom right-hand part of the slide set, which is covering the normal connect, and collaborate, and communicate logos. Apologies to Marcoms. So as I say, we'll take a look at the GN3 Plus service catalogue and hopefully a vision of what it would look like when we exit. So we're a two-faced bunch of people in product management. We've got a backward-looking face and a forward-looking face. So if I just build these slides for you, what we've done backward-looking is to spend quite a bit of time with the GN3 tasks and activity leaders integrating product management into the service sets. So essentially for us, there are four phases of product management. There's a strategy phase, there's a design phase, there's a pilot phase, and a production phase. And for us, it's very important that we understand who the user communities are who are going to be using our products and services prior to actually going ahead and building them. So that hasn't always been the case in the past. We've understood our target user base. So we've spent some time working with task and activity leaders, making sure that all of the phases of product management are adequately researched and documented. So we put in place that lifecycle management process, and as I say, we've put that in place for the network services, which are all of the things we're familiar with, things like Giant IP, Giant Lambda, and so on. And then we've also put it in place for multi-domain services like Bandwidth On Demand and Persona. Product management also doesn't just deal with the introduction of services, it deals with the lifecycle management, as the clue says in the title, and also with the cessation of services. And in multi-domain network services in the GN3 portfolio, we have actually ceased the multi-domain wavelength service, and that's allowed us to refocus effort more sensibly in GN3 Plus into looking at multi-domain VPN services. The same is also true for user applications. So these are your EduRoam, EduGame, EduPKI services. We've put a bit of work into ensuring that those services also fit into the PLM structure. So in most instances, we have business cases and value propositions for those services. And again, we're able to look at the value of those services to our user communities and make sure that if they're not adding value, then we can refocus efforts into services which we believe are more valuable. So that's what we've done retrospectively. Obviously, we can't spend all our time looking backwards, so we've got some forward-facing things that we're doing. I guess lessons learnt from GN3 are that very large activities are very hard to manage, they're hard to deliver, they're hard to understand. So in GN3 Plus, we've tried to slice and dice the product set into smaller deliverables and make the tasks smaller but quicker to market. So new services are being built with that in mind, and they're being built with capturing user requirements so right back at the start of the design process, so we know what the user requirements, the service requirements are, as well as the technical requirements. So there's a new focus on service, and you'll have probably seen that our operations department here has reorganized recently, and one of the functions in the ops team now is a service assurance activity, and that's primarily there as a way to make sure that we understand the service needs of our users rather than just the technology needs. So I've pretty much said that. We introduced PLM into the project during last year. It required a change to the processes, which I've just described to you, but it also required some changes to skill sets. So we spent quite a bit of time undertaking a training activity in Zurich and another one in Amsterdam last year. And again, we'll have to do that as we go forward into GN3 Plus with the new PLM, which is being developed for the GN3 Plus service set. So there's an ongoing training activity there. And also, there's quite a bit of reliance on our IT teams to ensure that the portal is kept up to date and remains accessible to all users with all browsers. Our goals were to get a single process in place used throughout the Jean project, and I think we've achieved that last year. And now we've laid the foundations for product lifecycle management, then it's fairly easy to go forward. People are trained on it, they know what to expect, and new services, as they're introduced, will come with the right set of documentation, the right service descriptions, the right pricing. It's relative. I think it's easy to use. Some people might disagree with me, but anyway, I think it's easy. And we have also integrated it with the project management framework wherever possible. So there's no point in duplicating work for the sake of it. So new idea forms, business cases, are the same forms that they use inside the PMF. The other key thing that comes out of managing your service set with a structured approach is the supply of management information. And on the PLM, you'll find KPIs, roadmaps, service descriptions, and service level agreement, or service level specifications, let's say, which apply to all the products and services that we're building now. Not all products and services have KPIs or SLAs. For example, I'm just trying to think, there's a couple of services that don't come with service level specifications. EduPert would be a good example. That's primarily a workshop and a knowledge base driven activity. So an SLA isn't necessarily appropriate there, whereas you would expect one for a network connectivity service. But all of those things are being published and kept up to date within the GN3 PLM site at the moment. We're building a new site for GN3 Plus, and that should be live by the end of this month. That's okay. So one of the other key things we've been doing inside the product management team is to define the service catalogue. What is a service? What isn't a service? Everybody in the project seems to have their own idea about what a service is, and so we thought we'd better put some rules in place to help us do that. So we spent quite a bit of time last year going through the entire service suite that Jean has produced over the years, trying to remove any unused services. And a good example would be E2E Mon, which we finally managed to close down last year. Multi-domain wavelength service, another example of a service which wasn't going anywhere. So those things have been closed and the resource reallocated. We try to deal with specials. A good example might be a multi-cast service at IP. It's very topical at the moment in one of our applications. And that is a special. It's not been productized in any way, shape or form, so there's no price for it. But we still recognize that there are users that need these specials, so we deal with those on a one-off case basis. We're also trying to coordinate where all this information is, and if I had a pound for every time I've had an email which said I'll send you a link to where that information is, then I'd be a very wealthy man. So instead of the got it approach piece of paper, we're trying to create a service menu of services that are well-defined and understood. Some of the other things we've been doing, we've rewritten specifications for all of the network connectivity services to reflect the take-up of the DTNX and MX service platforms, and business development have worked with us to communicate that out through the project, and that's been very useful. And then finally, something that's really important for us as we go forward as a project is looking at the cost base for all our services so that we're able to support new user types. Not all of our products and services are used by NRENs, and many of the clients we're having to deal with these days are non-NRENs, and there's some examples there of three or four of them that we're dealing with. And in order to provide services to these users, we have to be able to cost our services from the ground up. So we know the cost of the fibre, we know the cost of the switches, we know the cost of the labour, operations, manpower, power and space, all of these things, so that we can start to build pricing for research communities which aren't NRENs. And that's something which we've put a lot of work in, and we're starting to build up a knowledge base of our baseline costs such that we can turn these prices around fairly quickly. Whether you can read that or not, I have no idea, but if you go to plm.giant.net and follow the link to the archive site, then you'll find that very, very quickly on the link that says Service Catalogue at the top of the screen. And essentially in GN3 Plus, the products and services that we recognise are down the left-hand side there. So you won't find things like Autobahn, but you will find Bandwidth on Demand. So for us, Autobahn is a tool, as is CNIS. They're tools that support a higher domain service. So we're only tracking the higher domain services and assume that the task leader or product manager will be responsible for tracking the tools that support their product or service at the higher level. In a single snapshot, that is our service catalogue. It tells you which service activity the product or service is created by, who the owner of the service is. So that's your focus point for any questions you might have on a particular service. And then the next four or five columns relate to documentation trails and audit trails. So where new idea forms, where the business cases are, where the product description, roadmaps and KPIs can be located. So one of the complaints we've had in the project is that you can't find information. Well, I'm not going to say every single line item or every hyperlink on that page is 100% accurate, but I will say that it's a damn sight better than it was a year ago. And if you find things that aren't correct, then just email us at plm@giant.net and tell us what you need corrected and we'll correct it. It's a very simple process. If you couldn't read the last one, you certainly won't be able to read this, but again, if you go to plm.giant.net and click Service Adoption, you'll see this table. And it's a real-time view of the uptake of all of the services by NREN. And that's something that the task leaders and product managers keep up to date quarterly. So if you want to find a like-minded partner that is using the same service as you, then that's a very simple place to find it. We said we are keeping track of KPIs, conscious of time, so we'll press on. But again, where relevant, there are KPIs for all of our products and services now in the service set. And if you simply go along to the KPI section of the PLM portal, then you can see the KPIs we're monitoring and the RAG status for those KPIs. And I think that particular one there is for Ed Jerome. So So thank you, Miro, for that. Again, these are updated quarterly, and they will be carried forward with the new KPIs in the new service set in GM3+. We have roadmaps. Again, some these are changing as products and services evolve. So that snapshot is a little bit out of date. That's 6 months old. That's an EduConf roadmap. And again, we're going to use the new features of 2013 to enhance that view. So there were some issues with the getting a good view of the roadmaps. But again, there should be a roadmap for every service there. And going forward, that's a simple place to see where, if you're looking for a particular feature or function, what the product or task leader has in mind for their own service. Okay, so if I go through the service catalogue at the end of GN3, we had three main service activities. SA1, which was networking. I seem to have a problem with the slide here because it's, I guess it's white text on a white background or something shocking. But the top red box is essentially SA1, the networking activities. SA2 is the middle box there, dealing with multi-domain. And SA3 at the bottom is the service activities that you can see. And a lot of these things in the JRAs, the functions inside the JRAs are inside the red boxes there. The plan is always to migrate as much we can technology inside the research activities into one of the four phases of the service activity. So I've got four columns there, strategy, design, pilot, and production. And if I take a look, as we exit GN3+, some of these functions have actually moved out of the JRAs now and are able to come forward into the service activities going forward. So things like OpenFlow there that I've just moved for you, now that's come straight into the design stage in the new GN3+ service activity under test beds. And so you'll find things like, well, CATS, a configuration tool for EduRoam, that's now in production. So you can see that we are actually making progress in moving what were research technologies in GN3 into the service catalog for GN3+. So as we exit GN3, the picture on your screen now is pretty reflective of the service catalog. What we did learn from GN3, I'll put these PowerPoint slides up on the showcase site so that you get better visibility of them if you can't see them on the screen here. We learned that big, larger service activities aren't easy to manage at some point. So we've split them into seven service activities, cunningly labelled SA1 to SA7, down the left-hand side of this slide. And we've started to ensure that any product or service produced in the SAs is under PLM management. So we're expecting business cases and roadmaps and KPIs, and product value propositions to be created for them. We've split the service activities, as I say, down into smaller, easier to handle things. But that hopefully helps us get some services to our user base more quickly. And we are definitely focusing now on end user services. There's only so much you can do with IP, and I think we've had 15 years crack at it, so it's time we did something a bit more exciting and moved up the value chain. So the focus on end user services is a theme for GN3+ and will most certainly be enhanced in GN4. And MI is better management information. So we've got the visibility of the roadmaps, the KPIs, we're managing this stuff on a quarterly basis. So we're able to track where services aren't being used or aren't being created successfully and reallocate that resource, I've said before. So we've got seven service activities there, and essentially we're introducing some new services in GN3+. So there's all our old favourites in SA1, Jount IP, Jount Lambdas, and Jount Plus. But we're also introducing new services like VPN services, we're introducing peering services, and we're introducing a layer 2 Jount Open Service. Hopefully we'll be piloting OTN functionality, fairly soon in SA1, as well as providing it in OTM functionally in SA1. SA2 is our test bed, headed up by Jerry Sobieski, and we're making reasonable progress there in being able to put together a test bed to test bed either SDN or OpenFlow technologies. The deliverables for that are in the first quarter next year, and the plan will be to get some pilot customers connected onto that test bed, and they can start doing their experimental research activities on a production style test bed. SA3 is pressing on with bandwidth on demand, extending it wherever required, adding features. But it's quite exciting, the piece of work inside there that Xavier Jeannin is doing in Renotaire with the multi-domain VPN service, and that's, as we speak, sort of heading towards a pilot, a very limited pilot, 4 or 5 NRENs inside the community looking to set up multi-domain VPNs on request across NREN through Xiaon to another NREN. So that's an interesting piece of activity. Inside SA4, headed up by Ivana, then you'll find the products like Persona and CMON is being introduced to replace the E2E MON service that we talked about discontinuing previously. So CMON is a circuit monitoring activity that will actually complement Persona and give ops teams a good multi-domain view of circuit status and circuit performance. We're also doing work with Persona to see whether we can more closely integrate that with the US version of Persona. There's a lot of work occurring in that space. And also at a more detailed level, then we've taken on board some work done in JRAs previously. And we're looking at a new version of Persona, Persona NC. That's currently sort of in the early stages of productization. And hopefully we'll see something out of that, not this calendar year, but in the second year of Xiaon. Again, a lot of these services will carry on with just straightforward enhancements to them as features are requested by our user base. And so in SA5, you'll see things like EduConf and EduGain, EduRoam, just having standard features added on to them. But also we're doing some interesting things in terms of the Global Video Alliance in SA5, where we're looking at expanding our presence on the global stage with setting standards, working together to see how we can make our web conf services more globally accessible with single directory services. So that kind of work is occurring inside SA5. And then finally in SA7, we've got the cloud services being headed up by Andres. And you heard from Fulvio last week about a piece of work that he's undertaking inside SA7, but there's a lot of work occurring in that space, and a lot of the user requirements we see from our large end users like the European Space Agency and such like are looking for services from SA7, from that portfolio there, to provide virtual machines, infrastructure as a service, and potentially software as a service solutions as well. So a lot of work in that space, and it really does impact many of the other services, because you need the network to deliver them, you need monitoring tools to monitor the services. So it's something that really makes use of the entire service portfolio. Well, I've now talked for 22 minutes, I think probably it's a good time to ask any questions that you might have. Like I say, unfortunately, it's a whistle-stop tour, but if you check out the PLM, you'll find more detail on these services there. But also on the GN3 Plus intranet service, if you go to the service activities, most of the service activities there have descriptions in detail of the work they're undertaking, and so you can get some more information in that space. Okay, so I'll stop talking at that point. See if anybody wants to fire any questions. So there's a question that says there's interest from some NRENs in the PLM system. Are we going to make it available? Not in its current form. I want to, obviously its current form is built around an older version of, I'll say the word SharePoint, because we're all open and honest in this world. So we're bringing it forward into GN3+, putting it up on SharePoint 2013. I've actually had some requests for sharing the services and product descriptions, the process, and more than happy to do that. I really need to find a way, I guess, to productize my PLM process. And maybe we can do something to put a roadshow in place for those NRENs that do have an interest. I've spoken to say two or three already that have expressed an interest in this. So the answer is yes, I can make it available. It's a question of working with the questionnaire there to find what's the best form. There's another question. Also, how many NRENs are following a product management process to manage their product portfolios? Question, and the answer is I've no idea. I've spoken to some of the larger NRENs that do have resource to do this, and they do parts of it. So the service management side is generally speaking a little bit on the lacking in this area. Obviously, pricing and managing the outbound content delivery, so the marcoms and the pricing, that's normally an area where the NRENs are fairly focused on. But I think I've seen one or two examples where service management per se is not formally in inside their processes. Okay, a question here. So, give likely relative limited number of multi-domain VPNs and the special nature. Is this likely to be a cookbook rather than a product? No, actually, Mr. Questioner, I can actually see applications for multi-domain VPNs in many, many places. I'll put my cards on the table. I can actually see that being very successful, where other services of a similar nature have been less successful. And the beauty of the multi-domain VPN is that it can be configured directly by the NRENs, by the tech staff inside the NRENs, by the ops staff. Doesn't require any resource from Dante or Géant. So if an operations person in NREN A wants to have a VPN to NREN B, and we're talking endpoints inside the NRENs, so institute to institute conceptually, then they can just pick up the phone, send an email to one another, and 5 minutes later that VPN will be up and running. So it's not quite bandwidth on demand, but it's almost sort of bandwidth by request. I'm not sure that's the service name I want to promote, but anyway, I do see it being quite useful. Okay.
Well, thanks, Toby. Thanks for your interesting presentation. I hope everyone can hear me. My audio has been doing funny things recently. So, thanks again for your very interesting showcase. Again, it's open. Okay. Still plenty of slots available. And please go ahead and request one from the main showcase page. The recording of this will be available to watch after the show, so you can relive this whole experience. It's also available to people who didn't see it the first time around, and same with all the showcases that have been that the people have told us that they wanted to be made public. That will certainly happen. So thanks again, and we'll see you all next week, and we'll have another subject to look at. And please keep those requests coming in. Thanks again. Take care.